وبلغنا رسوله الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين الشاكرين، بقلب سليم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم. Obey Allah, obey the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and obey those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put an authority over you. أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. Those أولياء, their criteria, Allah described them, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. They accepted the truth, they acknowledged their Lord, and they lived a life in full awareness of their servanthood, that they are servants of that Lord. In their every breath, in their every moment, every minute in their life, they were not heedless. They were not dreaming, dreamwalking. They were not. Now we are end of times people, akhiru zaman, and now we are in the ibadah, we are outside the ibadah. In our dhikr, we are making other dhikr. In our prayer, we are doing business. Awliya, in every moment, there is a principle in the Naqshbandi tariqah. It says that to be, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, to be in khalwa amongst the people. You are dealing, you are selling, you are, but your heart is with Allah. No. How far are we now? How far are we from this a'lam? How far are we from tabi'in? How far are we from sahaba? How far are we from the imams of sahaba? From Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Uthman, Sayyidina Ali, Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. And we live now, we are witnessing, even with everything that's happening, people are not waking up. We are not waking up. In one instance, they say the earthquake in Turkey and Syria is equivalent, some said 1,000 nuclear bomb. Some say 500 nuclear bomb going off at once, that area. The equivalent energy that was released. And when we read the hadiths that Prophet ﷺ was saying to when he went to Taif, and Allah sent Sayyidina Jibreel, and with him Malakul Jibal, and he said to Prophet ﷺ, if you give permission, he will put the two mountains together on the whole city. That's how easy it is. One angel. And one angel of Sayyidina Jibreel, spanning from east to west, and you can see the limits of where it ends, and he has 600 of them. If Allah wanted, but his lutf, Allah is latif. Allahu latifun bi'ibadi. Allah is caring. Even in his tribulation, even in the difficulty, even in the tragedy, there's mercy and lutf. You see many people saying, oh, look, the punishment. Yes. With tribulation and difficulty, three things could be happening at the same time, simultaneously. Allah could be raising the ranks of some. He could be erasing the sins of some, and he could be punishing some, all in the same act. That man, that Naqshbandi Muqaddam of his Shaykh in Turkey, that his head is sticking out with the Shahada and making Dhikrullah with his Tasbih and Wird. From which ones are these? He's waking up before in Tahajjud time, sitting and saying Allah. These people should be happy that Allah took them in that state. That's why we tell people you have to have a wird. Why? Why you have to have this? Why you have to make dhikrullah? Because that man didn't start making dhikr that morning. He didn't begin that fajr. He didn't just wake up and say, today I'm going to start. He's a dhakir. He's a man of awrad. He's a man of wird. That's why he was up at that time. So when we tell people, it's not a one-off. You come do zikr once a month. You come do mawlid once a month. And then you go back. No. Every day. وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ اذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. On this occasion, last time we were here, and this is Masjid Sayyida Fatima, it was the urs of Sayyida Fatima, alayha salam, alayha rum. Tonight, subhanAllah, is it coincidence? I don't think there are coincidences. Tonight we are here for what? For Sayyidina Ali's birthday in the month of Rajab. Also, same day. Yeah. Subhanallah. And what can you say about Sayyidina Ali? And if we stay here from now till next Saturday, next month, speaking about the manaqib, the fada'il of Asadullah al-Ghalib, Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, أهل التقى والنقى والحلم والكرم. The first ulama deferred, but about who is the first one to be Muslim, male Muslim after. Some say Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, some say Sayyidina Ali. كرم الله وجهه ورضي الله عنه. Why we say كرم الله وجهه? He never worshipped a sanam, never bowed down to anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored, sanctified his face. Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib رضي الله عنه وارضاه. At the age of 8, he accepted Islam. And there are many narrations in the seer. He said, Prophet ﷺ received the wahi on Monday. I was a Muslim on Tuesday. First to pray behind Prophet ﷺ. At the age of 8. And look, inayatullah. Inayatullah is such that Sayyidina Muhammad ﷺ is orphaned when he's a child. That his grandfather leaves this dunya, and he entrusts him to Sayyidina Abu Talib. Why Sayyidina Abu Talib? Because he is al-akhu al-shaqiq. Sayyidina Abdul Muttalib had many children, but the one who was brother from both mother and father was Sayyidina Abu Talib. And he had many children, and he had a very poor household. And he took Prophet ﷺ and he favored him over all his children. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would not allow anybody to come eat, it said, before Prophet ﷺ was there from his children. So Prophet ﷺ Al-Karim ibn al-Karim alayhi salawatullah, the honored one, son of the honored ones. His personality was such he wanted to return that favor to his uncle. So he took one of his children to raise in his household. And who that child was? Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib. Look, there's no coincidence. Don't think this is happening now. Even your rizq has been decreed 50,000 years, it is said, of Allah's years before Adam was created. So there's no, it is from يَوْمِ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ, even from wherever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that Sayyidina Ali's maqam and station and rank and honor has been decreed to be the cousin of Sayyidul Khalq, to come into this world and to be taken into the hijr, into the household of Prophet to be raised under his gaze, to be raised with his love and kindness. And then at the age of 8, like someone, how old is your son?
7.
This young to accept Islam and to be the first one to accept Islam. What kind of rank is this? Yani, who are these people? No one really reflect on that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his inayah chose him to be that one for Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like he chose Sayyida Fatima to be the daughter of Sayyidul Khalq alayhim salam. So even if we just reflect upon this fact, it's enough for us. But I will go over some of the fada'il of the Prophet ﷺ, and I'm giving this introduction so you understand. Sayyidina Ali said, وَالَّذِي فَلَقَ الْحَبَّ وَبَرَأَ النَّسْمَ إِنَّهُ الْعَهْدُ النَّبِيِّ الْأُمِّيِّ أَنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّنِي إِلَّا مُؤْمِنِ وَلَا يُبْغِضُنِي إِلَّا مُنَافِقِ. Sayyidina Ali is saying, by Allah, who fashioned the seeds from which trees grow, and who fashioned the soul of things to come, it is the Prophet's ahd. Means Prophet ﷺ told him, this is your covenant, that anyone who loves you is a believer, and anyone who hates you is a munafiq. He is the test. رضي الله عنه وارضاه. That you cannot be a mu'min if you don't love Sayyidina Ali. كرم الله وجهه ورضي الله عنه. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله. Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم also named him Abu Turab. And the story is that he left the house one day upset, and he went to the masjid to sleep, and he had some turab, some dust on him. And Prophet ﷺ went to Sayyida Fatima alayhi salam, and he asked her, where is he? She said, he left, he was a little bit upset, and he left. He went and found him in the masjid, and he saw the dust on him, and he was wiping the dust of him and saying, "Stay, get up, Abu Turab. Qum, Abu Turab." And that kunya was the favorite of Sayyidina Ali because Prophet named him. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Later on, some will use it as a degrading, as something degrading. But even subhanallah, these people are mahfuz. They are calling him by his favorite name even when they mean something else. Allah. Another is when Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in Khaybar said, tomorrow لأعطينا الراية رجل يحب الله ويحبه الله. That tomorrow I will give the banner to a man Allah loves. He loves Allah and Allah loves him. What more certification? This is Sayyidina Ali. رضي الله عنه وأرضاه. يفتح الله على يديه. That Allah سبحانه وتعالى will open that place with his effort, with his hand. And there is many narrations of this hadith, and one of them is that the next day all the Sahaba came to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, everyone coming hoping to be that one, hoping to be that one. Who doesn't want to be loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Who doesn't want to be certified? So they're all coming, hoping. And then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, where is Ali? And it is said that Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik alayhi. They told him, Sayyidina Ali, his eyes have ramad. He's having problems and infection in his eyes. He's not able to come. He said, call him for me. And he spit in his hand. ودلكها. Some say he spit directly in his eye in the narration. And wiped over the eyes of Sayyidina Ali. رضي الله عنه. فبرأ. In the moment, instantly, his eyes were 100%. And in some of the narration, he said, then he gave him the raya, he gave him the banner. Some he said, in the narrations, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Later on, there's an explanation to that. He also gave him his sword, and he also gave him his amama. Rajulun. يحب الله ويحبه الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم رضي الله عنهم وأرضاهم. And in that battle, the champion of the Yahud Khaybar, his name was Marhab, a young man. And he was boasting and reciting shi'r, reciting poetry. قَدْ عَلِمَتْ خَيْبَرُ أَنِّي مَرْحَبًا شَاكِ السِّلَاحَ بَطَلٌ مُجَرَّبًا. They used to do that. So the champion of will come out and say, come if you can. I am such and such, I am who and who. Come, show me who you are. Send me the best ones from you. So one of the Muslims, Sayyidina Amir, went to challenge him, and he was martyred. Then Sayyidina Ali, when he came, Sayyidina Ali recited these verses. أَنَا الَّذِي سَمَّتْنِي أُمِّي حَيْدَرَ كَلَيْثِ غَابٍ كَرِيهِ الْمَنْظَرَ أُوفِيهِمْ بِالصَّاعِ كَيْلَ السَّنْدَرَ. He says, أَنَا الَّذِي سَمَّتْنِي أُمِّي حَيْدَرَ. He says, my mother named me حَيْدَرَ, which is lion. One other word, Arabic word for lion. كَلَّيْثِ, he said, like a lion. When you see a lion coming for you, how you feel? Huh? He said, كَلَّيْثِ. كَلَيْثِ غَابٍ كَرِيهِ الْمَنْظَرِ. He says, when you see me in the battle, I am like a lion coming for you. And he went and with two strikes, Marhab was gone. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened the siege for the Muslims on his hand. There's a يعني أولياء الله, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unveils to their hearts. And our Shaykh used to say in this story of Khaybar, there is much more to it. That when Prophet spit in his eyes, he was alone with him, called him to his tent, and he opened his eyes, Sayyidina Ali, and Prophet ﷺ said, "Look at me." And when he looked at him, he said he saw from his belly to his chest, he said, the whole world disappeared, and I can only see Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. But he couldn't see his head. And then he said, look down, and he looked, he said, seven earths, and I couldn't see beyond his knees. This is what our Grand Sheikh Abdullah Faiz Daghestani was speaking about, and maybe other mashayikh also may have had this story passed down through their turuq, is لَوْلَاكَ لَوْلَاكَ لَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْأَفْلَاكَ, is that Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, Allah created all creation from him. But not all the Sahaba witnessed this. We know later on, Prophet ﷺ gave a wasiyah to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu arda, and Sayyidina Umar. And he said to them, there is a man from Yemen. His description is such and such. If you see him, give him my salams. And in some siyar it says to give him his cloak as well. And ask forgiveness. Ask him to pray for you. So he's asking the wazirs of Prophet ﷺ to go to this man and ask to pray. And later on they meet him and he asked them, any of you saw Prophet ﷺ? And that's Sayyidina Uwais al-Qarani, who never met him physically. His nisbah to Prophet was always his spiritually, his ruhaniya. He never met him. That's why his rank as a sahabi is not considered a tabi'i, because he never met him. And when he met them, he said, did any of you saw Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And Sayyidina Umar, it is said that he said, yes, we were with him every day. He said, oh, you didn't see him. And then Sayyidina Ali said, I saw him once. Radiallahu anhu arda. And our Shaykh used to say, the only two people from the companions who reached their amana, who reached their trust, spiritual inheritance in this world, in the life of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu arda, from all 124,000. The others reached it after, but in the life, the only two that never objected to anything Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were like a dry leaf taken by the wind. Whatever Prophet said, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. And the only time both of them didn't accept what Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or seemed to object, was one time Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu wa arda, when he was Prophet ﷺ in his illness, the people said that Prophet ﷺ is not able to come, and he was leading the prayers. And when Prophet ﷺ arrived, came to pray, Sayyidina Abu Bakr took a step back to that Prophet, and Prophet was saying, no, you stay, like this. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr kept walking back to the back to allow Prophet to lead. And when later on confronted, Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu says, مَا كَانَ لِإِبْنِ أَبِي قُحَافَ. He said, it is not incumbent upon the son of Abu Quhafa, his father, to lead the messenger of Allah in prayer. So, adab. The only time they objected was out of adab. Because the adab, he couldn't. Yani Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq couldn't see himself to be standing in front of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. There is no way he could do it. The second time this happened was with Sayyidina Ali karramallahu wajha radiyallahu anhu. Why? Is Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, when Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to Sayyidina Ali, and he was kana katib Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he used to write for Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So he said, write min Muhammad Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wasallam to such and such. And the I think it was Suhail, he later on became Muslim, he was the one bargaining with on behalf of Quraysh. And he said, if we believe you are Prophet, why are we even talking here? Why are we fighting? We don't believe. So say, min Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Sayyidina Ali, erase it. Sayyidina Ali said,
no, I can't.
How am I going to? I can't erase it. By Allah, I cannot erase it. And did Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam know the ishq of Sayyidina Ali, know the honor of Sayyidina, know the respect of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, know the love of Sayyidina Ali for him? So he said to him, okay, show me and I will wipe it. The only two times they objected. So our Shaykh used to say, because of that, they were the ones that received their amana in the life of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if you know that all turuq, their nisba, their isnad is to two.
Subhanallah.
All tariqa. Qadiriya, Sahrawardiya, Shadiriya, Shistiya, Waisiya, everything goes through Sayyidina Ali. The only tariqah goes through Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu is Naqshbandiya. Those two. So the spiritual dispensation of Prophet's knowledge and inheritance came through these two. Radiallahu anhu wa rada. I don't know how much time, if I continue reading these hadiths, we'll be here till 1 a.m. maybe.
We're still talking.
We are enjoying.
At least 10-15 more minutes for
talking.
Sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Hu lahu. And one of the specialties of Sayyidina Ali is that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the also the Aam of Khaybar, when he gave him the raya, when he gave him the raya and spit in his eye, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma adhib anhu al-harra wal-qar. Oh Allah, keep away from him cold and hot. It is said that sometimes Sayyidina Ali would be seen in the heat of the desert in midsummer wearing wool. Wearing a wool jubba and a wool and not breaking any sweat. And would be seen sometimes with just a light shirt in the winter time. Where everybody is no problem. Dua al-Nabi. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And it is the highest of these traits is that Sayyida Fatima radiallahu anha wa ardaha, when she became of age, who came to engage her? Who came to ask for her hand? Sayyidina Abu Bakr. You see the Sahaba, they wanted to be attached to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. بالصحبة, with spiritual inheritance, with family, with, they wanted to be glued to him in any way. Salawatu Rabbi wa salamu alayhi. Even Sayyidina Umar came and asked for Sayyida Fatima alayhi salam. Why? Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Sayyidina Abu Bakr, she's too young. Sayyidina Umar said she's too young. Radiallahu anhu wa arda. And then when Sayyidina Ali was shy because he was a poor man, he didn't have much dunya. They had nothing.
Allah.
He was shy to go ask because he didn't know how to. So finally he was encouraged to go. He goes in the presence of Prophet, he couldn't speak. And then Prophet ﷺ says, maybe it is your coming to ask for Sayyidah, for Fatima. He said, yes. He said, well, what do you have to give her? He said, I have nothing, O Prophet ﷺ. He said, what happened to the shield? This old shield Prophet gave him as a gift. He said, what happened to that one? He said, I still have it, but I don't know. He said, no, bring it. An old shield that Prophet ﷺ gave him. Salawatu Rabbi wa salamu alayhi. And he gave her to Sayyidina Ali. It is enough honor that Safinatul Najat, Ahlul Kisa, that the lineage of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is coming from the sulb of Sayyidina Ali. To be the father of the progeny of Sayyid al-Mursaleen. And what honor can there be more than? What more, what else can you say after that? When Sayyidina al-Hasan, Sayyidina al-Husayn, and all their descendants till Judgment Day, they look at Asadullah as their father. What more minna, what more azama Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave this family. And for Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the Christians came to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they were arguing with him, and Allah says, فَإِنْ حَاجُّكَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَكَ الْعِلْمُ فَقُلْ أَسْلَمْتُ وَجْهِيَ
لِلَّهِ وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِ.
فمن حاجك به من بعد ما جاءك من العلم تعالوا ندعو أبناءنا وأبناءكم ونساءنا ونساءكم أنفسنا وأنفسكم ثم نبتهل فنجعل لعنة الله على الكافرين.
الله أكبر.
على الكاذبين.
الله لا إله إلا
الله. This is the mubahala. They came and they were giving Prophet hard time. He was trying to share with them the truth, and they were giving him a hard time. He says, okay, fine. Allah says to him, if they keep arguing with you, tell them, come. Bring me your families, your children, and let us, your wives, your children, and yourselves, and come, and let's meet. And let us curse the liars. So it is said that Prophet ﷺ in that occasion, who did he bring? Ahlul Kisa. This is his family. Those are his children. Salawatu Rabbi wa salamu alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad al-Fatih lima ughliq, al-Khatim lima sabaq. And it is said that there's another narration when the verse إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. When the verse came that Allah, verily Allah wants to keep away all dirtiness, all badness away from أَهْلُ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرُكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا, and purify you, that he came out from his house and he called Sayyidina Ali, Sayyidina Fatima, Sayyidina al-Hasan, Sayyidina al-Husayn, put them under his aba'ah, under his kisa, and he said, these are my family, these are Ahlul Bayti, alayhim ridwanullahi ajma'in. And to show you the qadr of Sayyidina Ali, that Sayyid al-Mursaleen radiyallahu anhu wa rahmah, Sayyid al-Mursaleen salawatu rabbi wa salamu alayhim, will end with this, that he said to him, man huwa ashqa al-awwaleen, Sayyidina Ali. He said, he asked him a question, who is the worst, the person with the worst predicament in existence from the previous times before me? And Sayyidina Ali said, radiyallahu anhu, aqir al-naqa, the one who killed the naqa of Sayyidina, the camel of Sayyidina Salih, the one who actually slaughtered the camel of Prophet of Allah, Salih, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade them to kill, the camel that appeared as a miracle from a rock. And Allah said to them, you, when it drinks, you can drink, only you drink sometime, and the camel drinks sometimes, and the ashqiya, that shaqi, came and slaughtered, killed. That was the worst human being from the before time. Who is? And then Prophet ﷺ said, وَمَنْ أَشْقَى النَّاسِ مِنَ الْآخِرِينَ, and who is the worst human being from those who are coming after me? And Sayyidina Ali says, اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَعْلَمُ. And Prophet ﷺ said, the one who kills you.
Allah.
The one who kills you is the worst human being. Naqa is a miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows its reality. But who is Sayyidina Ali? Who was that one? During the last final 3 years of Mawlana Sheikh Nazim, my teacher, may Allah sanctify his soul, he used to sit every day, starts his suhbah, and we are Naqshbandis. So, but Awliya Allah, when they reach the rank of someone like Mawlana Sheikh Nazim, then the lines between tariqah disappear, becomes a Muhammadan way. And he used to sit every day, he starts his talk. Madad ya Shahi Mardan. In Turkish, he would say, Madad ya Shahi Mardan. Your lovers are hayran, your lovers are in awe, are astounded. And then he would sit and say, the field is yours.
Allah.
Indicating that that knowledge that Mawlana Sheikh Nazim the last 3-4 years was coming from the heart of Sayyidina Ali, karram Allah wajah, wa radiyallahu anhu. We must believe again. There's no time. We must believe in more than this. More than this. Really believe. I'm telling this to myself, first and foremost. Our Sheikh used to say, when you sit to talk, know that this is first for you, not the listeners. We must believe, because if you read the hadith of end of times, Prophet ﷺ said, when you see this, when you see that, when you see this, فَعْلَمْ, know that the hour is upon you. We've seen everything. كَثْرَةُ الزَّلَازِلْ now. The frequency of all these things happen. The wars, the killings before that. الْهَرَجُ وَالْمَرَجُ. We are seeing, but who is... who is man yatta'id, man ya'tabir? Who is actually taking heed? These a'lam, these banners of tuqa and nuqa, these sahaba, they lived, if you read their lives, they sacrificed everything in Allah's way. And they lived every moment in taqwa, in wara. They had nothing. teaching us not to rely on this dunya. We've said this before, one of the wisdoms that I love, that I heard regarding Sayyidina Ali is that one person came to him, radiallahu anhu arda, and said to him from his students, he said to him, tell me, am I from the people of dunya or the people of akhirah? Am I from the lovers of dunya? Is the dunya taking over my heart? And Sayyidina Ali said to him, radiallahu anhu, said, it's very easy. You know yourself. If someone comes and gives you now of the wealth of dunya, and someone comes and takes from you that wealth, which one will make you happy? If the one who gave you dunya makes you happy, you're min ahl al-dunya. You're a dunyawi person. You're a dunya person. Why? Because he's giving you, he builds your dunya. He gives you some money, you go buy something, it's dunya. Or you build something. He said, but if you are happier when somebody asks you, if someone comes and says to you, give me, for Allah's sake, give me $1,000, and someone gives you $1,000, where are you happier? This is the wisdom of Sayyidina Ali. You know yourself, he said. If you are happy with the one you gave for Allah's sake, you are from the people of dunya, because why? You are building there. You're not building here. And one person came to Prophet and he was showing off to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu ardan, was showing off that, you know, he despises dunya. Dunya is this and dunya is that and dunya is this. And Sayyidina Ali says, he says, ما أحسبك إلا إذا أنك تحب الدنيا. He says, I can't say anything except that you must love dunya so much. Since you came here, you're making the dhikr of dunya. All you speak about, dunya. Even you're speaking badly. But see, this is the importance of zikr. Sayyidina Ali left this world on Sunday, the 19th of Ramadan. And he was hit with the sword on his head on Friday, the 17th. The day of Badr. After he used to leave his house, wake up people on his way to come and pray, and he was martyred. 2 days after that, he didn't speak any word for 2 days until Sunday, except La ilaha illallah.
SubhanAllah.
From the moment he was hit until afterwards, he only spoke La ilaha illallah. تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ. These people now, where are they? They've done their best. What about us? Let us be, again, let us be lions against our lowerness. Let us follow the example of Sayyidina Ali and start with our own nafs. Let us spend time in Allah's remembrance daily. Not just weekly or monthly. Let us have a word of Salah ala Nabi. Let us give from our wealth before our time is up. Let us fight. Let us be warriors like him. At least make intentions. Ya Rabbi, you gave a human being all these traits. Ya Allah, dress us with a drop from that. Dress us with a drop from these characteristics of Sayyidina Ali. To be real Muslims, real mu'mins, real muttaqeen. Wa min Allahi tawfiq, bi hurmati al-habib, bi hurmati al-fatiha. Salli ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. As a mawlid. Inshallah, remembering the holy ones it is the Mawlid of Sayyidina Ali today. We're coming to remember him also. But before I give the mic, one thing is يُبْعَثُ الْمَرْءُ حديث النبي على ما مات عليه. A person leaves this dunya, the way he leaves this dunya, he'll be resurrected. We will stand in the presence of Allah, we will be resurrected according to how we leave this dunya. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu Allah was a lion and a lover of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He fought in the way of all his life. He was a mujahid. He was a alim. He was, we didn't even speak about his ilm because that's an ocean. But he left this dunya how? Calling people to come to pray. Standing and leading imam being in prayer. And he was martyred. No one could face him, so he was martyred ghadr from behind while he was praying. And he left dunya on dhikr la ilaha illallah for 2 days. He didn't speak a word except la ilaha illallah. Question is, how they spend their life in pleasing Allah. So when they leave dunya, they leave it in a way that is pleasing to Allah and pleasing to them as well. So we need to have our priorities straight. How many people leave dunya that make qiyamul layl, leave dunya in sajda? How many people of dhikr, like this gentleman, his picture is viral. Naqshbandi brother from Turkey, his hand.
Yeah, he was reading
and Fatiha, his hand is like this.
Yeah.
His hand is like this. Out of the wall, like this. At 4 o'clock in the morning, tahajjud time, 5 time. He's sitting in dhikr. And he dies, like this. Why is he doing this? Is for our youth. Why is he in that? Why Allah granted him that? Because he's daily doing that. Every day. Because daily he does his wird. A wird is something you do daily, like you eat. Every day he's doing his awrad, his afkar. So Allah took him in that state. So what are we doing every day? What is our priorities? What our children are doing? Are we going to leave dunya with on dhikrullah, praying, charity? What are we going to do?
He wants to say something.
Huh?
You want to say something?
Inshallah, may Allah make us from that. So that's why we follow tariqah. Why you go to the shaykh? He gives you this for what? This is practice for death.
He have a question.
Yeah. He wants to say something.
When Ali only said La ilaha illallah for 2 days, he didn't say any other Arabic word when he was praying the mosque.
Well, he couldn't. He hit him with a sword on his head. And he was the sword was poisoned. So for 2 days he was not leading to the prayer, not standing. He was in, but nobody heard him say any word except La ilaha illallah after that. So when they're praying, they're praying. But outside of the prayer, nobody heard Sayyidina Ali say anything else except La ilaha illallah for 2 days.
Sure, there's a question like
question. No.
Maybe you can take
very good question.
5 minutes question. But when we say like we're gonna be fight like Ali, that means like in the iman, like in the like what does it mean for us? Definitely we are not fighting physically for anybody, but how we can, like we have so many struggles, correct? The struggle in the sense of people bringing in the masjid for programs, bringing people in the masjid in namaz, correct? We keep trying, we are sending messages, talking, asking people to become, join, but it's still like sometimes feel frustration too, correct? Like, you know why people is not connecting, even though you are...
So the ladies can hear.
Yeah. Yeah, so my question is... Yeah, my question is in the little bit on the fighting. You said like, fight like Ali.
Yeah. Because that's the teaching of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam.
Yeah, so that means like definitely in this time we don't find hands with the people. Say, okay, come in the masjid or come to this program or do like whatever the one of us say. So how we can achieve this? Because sometimes you feel frustration in the sense of, oh, you make a mahfil but people don't show up, correct?
Mm.
Or they don't come for the namaz. You keep asking people come for the jama'ah.
Mm.
And the people come like one or two or three people. Like even Imam Sahib is keep preaching people and saying, okay, please come for jama'ah. But still, we are really so comfortable to praying at home, correct? So how we can achieve this goal, like, or mentally feel, okay, I'm trying my best, whatever I can, but definitely live for the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
There is many ways to call people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one that's overlooked most now is to call Allah with your hal, with your state, not your words. To call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by exhibiting the prophetic characteristics, by beautifying yourself with the manners of Sayyidina Muhammad of hilm, forbearance, of sweetness, of mercy, of patience, of sidq, truthfulness. These characteristics, when you're dealing with people and they see someone who's dressed with that, and in their moment when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to bring them back, when they're ready, they remember, where do I go? Oh, I know.
I think this is a testing point from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So I go to the Shaykh, to the Imam, because I don't know anybody who is sweeter than him, who is somebody truthful, somebody helps others, and so forth. But before you do that, how do you get that? How do you get the prophetic characters? How do you become on the path of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? There you have to struggle, because if we struggle against, our Shaykh teach us, Mashaykh, this is a prophetic teaching. We have four enemies: nafs, hawa, shaitan, dunya. Our nafs, our ego, I want, I like, I need, me. Oh, you did this to me, you said that to me, me. All day, me dhikr.
Yeah.
Dhikr of me. Yeah. I. They even have a song, me, whatever. That's it. So our dhikr, instead of Allah, Allah, it's me. Why? I tell my kids sometimes, jokingly, but it's not a joke. I said, don't let your donkey take you by the rope and say, what do you mean by donkey? I said, it's your nafs.
Oh, no.
Your nafs is animalistic, instinctual, it doesn't want anything from akhirah. It wants only this temporary pleasure. Food, feed me, give me, build for me, buy me, that's it, that's all it wants. So that's your first enemy, shaitan. Inna shaitana lakum aduwan fattakhidhuhu aduwan. Allah says to us, shaitan is our enemy. Shaitan, he's jealous of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He thought he was that one. He thought he was the one to be taken. That Maqam al-Mahmud, that praiseworthy station, is for him. And then he found out it wasn't for him. He got upset. So he got angry. And we all know the story. So he said, I'm going to show you they're not worthy. Instead of asking forgiveness for his transgressions, he says, no, I'm going to show you. Allah gave him life. He's our sworn enemy. The third one is dunya. Love of dunya. حب الدنيا رأس كل خطيئة. Love of dunya is the head of every sin. We want more, more dunya, more houses, more resources, more bank accounts, more land, more real estate, more. Dunya, dunya beckons. Beckons, come. Many of you came before you. They're now under my. Many of you wasted their whole life chasing me. And hawa is vain desires. Our instinctual characteristics that I like and I don't like. I want and I don't want. So those are four enemies. Everybody is busy with somebody else, and their enemies are running a circus. One second. Everybody is looking. Oh, Arfan, why you're sitting like this? Why you're doing that? But you, what about you? Allah is not going to ask me about Arfan.
Yeah.
He's going to ask me about me. Is Allah going to say why Arfan? I'm just using Arfan here as an example. Why he did this? Why he did that? He's not. So. You go back to the prophetic hadith. What Prophet ﷺ said, the meaning of the hadith, if Allah wants to afflict somebody, He makes him busy with the faults of others. Because you have a limited time to correct your own faults, and you're busy with other people's faults. So that's why you have to struggle. You have to fight against your nafs. You have to fight against your shaitan. You have to fight against hubb al-dunya, love of this world. You have to fight. If you don't fight, your enemies will overrun you and your life is wasted. And how do you fight? Prophet ﷺ used to say, we came back from the small jihad to the grand jihad. What was the grand? This. To overcome your nafs, to own yourself. That's... So that then, once you've done that, you can go to others.
Allah.
And you can go and say, help others.
Just help yourself.
But first, most.
Help yourself.
You have to find a way. And the way, through passed from Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, is suhbah. Is to find people better than you, people who have those characteristics, people who have mahabba, prophets, people who have taqwa, and attach yourself to them. That's the easiest way. Because when you're with them, what they're going to do? Salah ala nabi, mawlid, they're going to teach you about something beneficial to you. They're going to remind you about Allah. They're going to, what they're going to do? That's it. So be with that. Find a keen eye master, find a sheikh that is, or people who are people of taqwa and mahabba, and be with them, and bring your children to them. If you hear somebody says, you know, there's a man of Allah somewhere, run to them. Mm-hmm. Even if he turns out not to be.
But it's still
you. But you run, because you're running for Allah. He's saying he's a man of Allah. And there was one of our grand sheikhs, Abdullah Dahlawi. Sheikh Abdullah Dahlawi in India. His grandfather was a person who has husn al-dhan. He thought good of everybody. He, you know, whatever you do, people do, he always gives them the benefit of the doubt. And he loved awliya. And he loved people of Allah. And he was a generous person. So every time they say, oh, there's a waliullah coming. He's a man of Allah. He would go, bring the person, open his house, invite people. He would, like this. Even if those people were not. But he was, that's his character. He would take his, if he knows somebody like that, another time he would take his family, his children, his grandchildren and go to visit. Until a day came where the Grand Master of the Naqshband, Sheikh Ahmed Farooq Sirhindi, Muhammad Masoom, his son, or Saifuddin, I think, was visiting and he saw him, and he had his grandson Abdullah Dahlawi with him, and he showed so much love and respect to the Sheikh. And the Sheikh said, your son is on our line. From his good manners and his husn al dhan. Sorry, you want to go ahead?
What's the difference between nafs and hawa?
Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Nafs, Sidi, is when you are... let's give you the difference between nafs and shaitan first. Nafs insists. That's how you know the nafs is different. So, nafs wants this water, or this thing. I want this. You have this voice inside. I want this piece, this blood. This bottle has liquor. We're not supposed to have liquor. No. After him, I want this. I want this. I want this. Okay? Insists that on sin. Insists on anything it wants. Shaitan doesn't care. Shaitan, he says, okay, have some alcohol. No. Okay, play, go gamble. No. Okay, why don't you...
do something else.
He doesn't care what sin. So when you're having whispers, you can distinguish. Hawa, Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad, man ittaba'a hawa. Hawa is the things we prefer, the likes and dislikes we have. You know, our temperament, our inclinations. You know, some people like sour taste, some people like sweetness, some people like yani the likes and dislikes, what attracts us.
Hawa can be good or bad.
Hawa can be good or bad. If your hawa, I mean, that's why Prophet ﷺ said, is you have to make your hawa taba'an la. So your hawa has to be your likes and dislikes erase, and your likes and dislikes become his likes and dislikes. When your hawa, your likes and dislikes become Prophet's likes and dislikes. These are awliyaullah. So they no longer, if they like sour and Prophet likes sweet, they like sweet. No more.
That's really good.
Yeah.